Imagine sending a link to somebody to collect their signature, but the link, when they open it, is full of a contract or an agreement that is custom built for them. Sound too good to be true? Well, that is the very thing we're building in this video, and we are not going to use a single line of code to do it. So if that's of interest, stick around and let's get into it. Hey, welcome back. My name is Gareth, and if you're new here, this channel is all about helping you to organize and automate your business processes without using a single piece of code. We use entirely no-code and low-code platforms, so if that's of interest, be sure to subscribe to the channel and check out the links below this video so that you can explore all the different resources we've put together to help you level up in this way. On that note, I do a weekly live training webinar I would invite you to attend if you want to learn how automation can help you reclaim your time. Personally, I save almost 20 hours per week using automation. And again, don't have to know how to code to do it. So if that's of interest, be sure to check the link below or visit me at garethpronovost.com/webinar-registration to sign up. And you'll get all that stuff. Even if you can't attend live, you will get a recording sent to your inbox. So without further ado, let's jump into the heart of this video. We are talking about building this process where we're going to custom craft this link so that when somebody receives it and is prompted for their signature, it's gonna be filled out with all their information. We are gonna start with a database in Airtable. So jumping into my screen here, you can see that I have a really simple example put up so far. I've got the project name, and this is a formula where I'm combining the client and the business name. So you can kind of disregard this. The important stuff here is that I have a first and a last name. I have a business name. I'm collecting an email address. And then this form URL stuff is part of the magic that we're going to build in order to get this all to work. So before I go into this, let's look at our form. On our form side of things, we have this beautiful form that's collecting the name, the email, and the business name. Now you can add any number of parameters here. Of course, I'm using these examples, first and last, email, business. So four different things here. You can pass as many as you want, more or less. So the gist of it though is I want to send out this agreement that you see here on my screen, and I want it to be filled out with information for this client, right? So that it's filled out uniquely for different businesses or different first and last names. And really the whole purpose of the form is to collect that signature. So how do I build this form? Well, first and foremost, even though I don't want these variables to show up on the final form, I have to have them in my form. And I'm going to be able to hide them, sure, but I need them here in order to populate the work agreement in this case with the right variable values. So in order to do this, I would suggest entering whatever variables you need into your form first. So for me, first and last name, email, business name, right? These are each their own element. You can add over from the panel on the left if you're using JotForm, or if you're using another form tool, I'm sure it has similar functionality as well. JotForm is my form tool of choice. I think it's really robust and it offers a lot of possibility. Okay, so once I've got these variables in play, then I'm going to add this section here. Now for JotForm, that is a short text element. So I'm adding this short text element to the form. Now inside of the text, when I click into this element, you see that I have a lot of flexibility. It's basically a Word document that I can edit. Any place that I want to enter a variable that occurred previously in my form, I can do that by using one squiggly bracket to open, put in the variable name, and then a closing squiggly bracket. Now you'll see that I've already filled this out for business name and for first and last name. And again, business name occurs a second time on this particular text block, but I haven't completed it yet for email. I put in a placeholder so that I could show you where to go to find out what the variable name is so that you can pass it through on further points into your form. Okay, so we're gonna look at our email element here. Click on the email element, go to the properties, and switch on over to advanced. Scroll all the way down and to your field details, you'll see the unique name of this field right here. If you just copy and paste it, that's the best way to make sure that you don't make a typo. So I'm just going to copy this unique field name. And now I'll go back into my work agreement text, and I just want to replace whatever's inside of those squiggly brackets. Please note that this is case sensitive. Okay. Now let's flip into our form, and I'll just go ahead and look at the published version of the form here by opening up this tab. And you'll notice that right now the text is completely blank anywhere that I had one of those variables, because I don't have data for those variables yet. But if I fill out the form, once that's all set, you see that the text updates as well. Perfect. So now imagine that the user didn't see the first few elements. Instead, they would just click on the link we provide, see this work agreement with the text that is relative to them and their specific business, and they'd be asked to sign. So we can go ahead and sign on behalf of the client and submit that document, right? Great. Now, how do we make sure that they don't have the option to alter those pieces of data? Well, we can go into the form, back to our build section within JotForm, and actually hide these properties, right? So if you scroll, again, go into the properties of each of these and scroll down on the advanced panel, you will find the option to hide this field. And as soon as you make that toggle selection, you'll see that the field is hidden and will not be visible on the form. However, it is still active. It's still going to capture data. So we're going to have to find a clever way to pass that information to the form so that the form is already preset with this data and the client or whoever is filling out the form on the back end has no way of even changing that. They don't even know it's there. So let's do this for all of our different fields. We'll go ahead and make sure that they are all hidden. So I'll go to advanced for all of our fields, for the full name, the email, and the business name, and toggle them all off. Now, when I go to this form, let's go ahead and open up a new version of the form here. You'll see that it has none of those variables available. It is simply the work agreement and prompt for a signature. Pretty cool. Now we have to pass those variables though. So how can we do that? We need to make sure that every time we fill out this form and send it to a client, it's pre-filled with client information, right? We don't want to have our client have to fill out stuff that we already know and, you know, just makes extra work for them, makes the process less seamless, less streamlined. So how do we pre-fill a form in JotForm? Well, they've put together some excellent documentation. You can scour their website. It's not hard to find. But my recommendation is to start with the actual form URL. Whatever that form URL is for you, just go ahead and copy it and then go into Airtable and publish a formula that has inside of quotation marks that form URL. This is a really clever hack because in the future, if you ever change that form URL, all you have to do is go in to this formula and replace it with whatever that form URL is, and it will update your form instantly throughout your entire Airtable database. Now, once we're set there, we're going to save this field. And now we're going to work on that pre-fill magic, okay? What we need to do is after the form URL itself, we need to string a lot more data on there so that when they click on the form URL, it's actually a unique URL that includes their first and last name. It also passes the company name and their email along. So I've already done this now for the first name. You can see in order to pass this, I need to first say question mark and then call out the field that I want to pre-fill. In this case, it's name with square brackets first inside and then equal sign. And then after that, I want to fill in the client first name. So in my particular case, in this first record here, that would fill out with the name Gareth. But in the second record here, it fills out with Walt. And you can see that in my form pre-fill, you can see the first name is being passed here as Gareth and here as Walt. Now, similarly, after that, I can add as many different variables as I want. So in my case, I also want to pass the last name. Now, after the first one, you need to start using an ampersand. So the first question mark basically says, this is my first pre-filled field. And then after that, for every subsequent one, be sure to use an ampersand. So now I'm going to say, and name last equals, and then I bring out the client last name. Similarly, and email equals email. Now, one thing I do want to point out, if you're referencing a field in Airtable, you don't need to surround it with quotations. But if you're not, if you're trying to add static text, for example, the static text of and email equals, then you have to surround that with either single or double quotations. Either one is fine. Just be sure that you're consistent every time. Okay. Now, you can see that I haven't completed this yet for the business name. I want to add the business name to this form as well so that that will also be pre-filled. So let's go ahead and look at how you can do that. Because the question you might ask is, how do I know what the field name is for business name? So let's go back to our form, and I'm going to right-click anywhere on the form, and I want to view the page source data. Now, if I scroll down here, you can see that there are a lot inside of a lot of codes. You're going to have to kind of go through and comb through this a little bit, but you can see that there are some fields that begin with Q and then a number and then an underscore and then the field name. So in this case, Q7 underscore email. This is the email field. The way I reference it, rather than filling out the whole Q7, is just grabbing that email part, right? Similarly, I can look at Q6 up here. Q6 name first. That's how I knew what the first name was. Q6 name last. They're the same question, but two different parameters within the question. So this is how I know what the last name parameter is, or variable name. So the last one I want to grab here, of course, is whatever we call the business name. So we have to go find it and see if we can find it here. We go Q8 underscore business name. Again, this is case sensitive. So I'm going to copy business name and I can close out my page source there. I'm going to go back into my formula and I'm going to add this, right? So after I've already passed the email address, I also want to pass the business name. So I say ampersand business name, I can just paste it in, equals, close out my quote, and now I have to bring in the business name. Now, a side note for you here, if I save this formula as is, it's going to be inadequate. And the reason for that is these business names have spaces in them. And so a space cannot exist in a URL because it doesn't know where it starts and stops. So in order to replace those spaces, you can see in my formula output here that the URL kind of stops at the space. So in order to replace that, I need to make sure to encode this little portion with a URL encode. So an encode URL component, I'm going to wrap this part of the formula around business name because I want to make sure to take that business name and encode it in a URL, which then replaces my spaces with %20s. Now this is a perfectly viable link and it is unique to both of my clients here. Here's Gareth at Gap Consulting, here's Walt at Walt Disney Co., and we're good to go. So if I go ahead and click on this link, it's going to open up now a complete work agreement where as the user, I cannot see that information, right? I don't know that I've passed my first and last name and my company name. I see that nowhere on this form. But on the form work agreement, in fields that I cannot edit, you can see that all of that data is being passed. So here's my name, here's my company name, here's my email address, and I can sign, and I can submit. Lastly, I can look at Walt Disney. Same thing here. Open up his link, Disney, Walt Disney, his email address. Go ahead and sign, submit. Now, the last part of this puzzle is to capture that submission from that form and to update my data in Airtable so that, as you see just happened, it says, hey, that agreement was just signed. So how do we do this? Well, one more fancy automation will do the trick. I build a catch hook, which is a fun way of connecting Zapier to my form in JotForm. So in order to do this, I simply choose a catch hook trigger, and then I copy this URL and paste it back in my form. So on my settings tab, back in my integrations within JotForm, I can integrate this with a webhook. And what this does, all I have to do is again, paste that URL here. And as soon as that is completed, then when a form is received, it automatically passes that data to Zapier and says, trigger this automation. Okay, so that is the trigger event. From there, you will find the corresponding record in Airtable. In my case, what I opted for was to find a record in my database, and I simply said, look for the email field that matches the email that you receive when the form is submitted. Remember, they can't edit that email address, so it should always match an email address that's already in your database. Perfect. So this will then find the email address or find the record with that email address. And then lastly, I want to take some sort of action within that record. So I simply say, the record that I identified in step two, that's this record ID, I just want to update it. In this case, I want to add a date to the agreement signed date field. So this is just a standard date field in Airtable, and I can use this parameter of zap metahuman now, which looks like this if you're typing it out, two squiggly brackets, zap underscore meta underscore human underscore now, two squiggly brackets. And this is going to take the timestamp of when this automation runs, it's going to plug it right into Airtable for us. And so even though on my particular case, I only have it set to date, it still copies over the date perfectly, or you can include a time field here as well and actually see the time that these things are updated. That's it for this video. I hope you got a ton of value from this. If you did and you'd like to learn more, do check out the links below, and I will see you in the next video.
As always, I hope you found that to be extremely helpful. If you did and you'd like to learn more, swing by our website and see how we can help. We offer a free Airtable crash course that will help you level up in Airtable quickly, and we also have some paid services, including hourly consultations with our experts. We have some online courses and a group coaching program, and for advanced needs, we can build a bespoke solution for you from scratch. So swing on by, and I look forward to connecting with you soon.